to do the film because I love the idea of doing a fairy tale, doing something imaginative, doing something that children would love, and that gives me, the idea gives me great pleasure. Some people call it science fiction. I don't even consider it science fiction. I consider it a fairy tale. In science fiction, you're very concerned about leaving a spaceship on a planet because there may not be oxygen, or the gravitational force is not the same as on Earth, or not what your body's adjusted to. And so you must take all that into consideration, or it's considered very poor science fiction. It's fairy tale. That's the environment. That's the context. But you can literally do anything. And if I believe it while I'm doing it, the audience tends to believe it too. So that's a fairy tale. I worked so long with the script that I know pretty much everything that's expected of the scene, and I just shoot the picture. And as I go along, I vary. I change my concept often because of what I shot before, or I learn something, or I learn that I don't need a certain scene, or I learn that I haven't shown a certain person before, and I have to show them now. There are about 1,000 little considerations before you can stage a scene, and you pay off things.
The story of Empire really takes off a little while after the end of Star Wars, and picks up the continuing adventure of Luke Skywalker and his friends into a conflict with the Empire that ultimately culminates in a personal confrontation between Luke and Darth Vader. There are a lot of other things that go on in the meantime, but that's really the principal focus of the story.
To me, it's very different from the first film because the shadings are much different. I mean, we do have an epic battle sequence, but it's not the climax of the film by any means. It comes very early. It's divided into three acts. The second act is Harrison and Carrie going off and their involvements being chased and chasing each other and the romantic thing. I mean, that's where he gets his big chance.
At first, she's a princess after all, and I'm an opportunist, a mercenary type. But it develops into a love story, as it were. Lovely girl, the princess.
Give me 3 weeks, you know, in hyperspace with her, you know, I might make a few points, you know. I'm so burned about that.
The poor dear. It's quite shocking. I think he's of course fond of the princess himself.
It starts out as a kind of triangle, and then I'm thrown together with Han Solo. Ends up being one of those relationships like Tracy and Hepburn or Bogart and Bacall or Fred Astaire and Ginger Rogers, where we scream at each other for the first half of the film, and step on each other and hit each other, and then we end up liking each other.
The second part of the film for me is a search for learning. I see visions of Alec Guinness, of Ben Kenobi, who tells me to search for his teacher, who taught Obi-Wan the Force. So I'm finding like sort of the grand master in Jedi, and it's training. So this is sort of intercut with the high action with them and the sort of samurai quiet training. It's sort of a marathon. Well, I'm studying with the master of the Force. And in the third act, you know, all hell breaks loose.
We go gallivanting through the galaxy and get stuck in a space slug and in a lot of intergalactic warfare. And then we all get trapped, and it's a lot of running away again and shooting and kissing. It's true.
It's basically the good triumphs over evil, isn't it? It's simple as that. The good guys win and the bad guys lose. Han's a good guy.
This is Dee, and I'm sure Skywalker is with them. Set your course for the Hoth system. General Veers, prepare your men.
In all fairy tales, it's important that the characters come to life for the audience and that the people associate with them in real terms. Therefore, the actors, the characters that are created and the actors who play them have to appear to be real so that their relationships between the characters, their moral values, their ideas, why they do things, have to be real to the audience. That's the whole point of a fairy tale, that it has a moral to teach. And it has to be subordinated in the story. It can't be obvious, but it is there. And the audience coming away from the story remembers certain things that happen that are very important. And that's what we're aiming for in all of the Star Wars films.
I can't talk now, I'm out of breath. It's really hard for the kids to... They showed a bit of the... Peter Diamond over here was the Tusken Raider that attacked me in the first Star Wars. And it's a wonderfully edited, wonderful action scene. And yet to see it on the special, sort of no sound effects, no music. We're out there in Africa, rolling speed. I fall on a little mattress, plump, you know, and Peter's through the mask saying, to your left now, to your right now, you know. It sort of destroys the magic. His kids come up to you later and go, that looks so fakey on TV. So that's why I'm a little nervous about watching the rehearsals, because they're going to make me look really good.
Look, yeah. Yeah. Did I?
Bam.
That's what you need there. Just a watch.
Okay.
You shoot the back leg out.
Right. One arm, though, not
yeah,
two.
That's right. Yeah. Right.
Okay.
A little surprising.
And I, too.
Then
down the stairs.
Now you're ready to swipe at him. That's it, no long guard.
Where was it that it fell out of my head?
When I went over your head there,
it was
there.
Remember?
Yep.
All right.
Here you go.
One, two, three. Stop. Now we stop. And I too.
The budget in dollars is approximately $18 million.
Corporation built this stage especially for this set. The stage itself is 250 feet long. We've added something in the order of 60 feet out of one end and another 20 feet out of one of the sides. So even though it's an enormous stage, still not quite big enough to accommodate the set as you see it now. The biggest set in the picture is, in fact, the Bob Planet, which comes later. It's the last set to be built here, which involves enormous trees that are something like 10 feet in diameter with incredible roots.
This is the main ice hangar that the Rebel forces are using to store their aircraft and spacecraft to hide from the Imperial forces. There are several of these hangars, this being the largest one that we see in the film, that are all underground on this ice planet. The reason it looks real is because it's part of our concept for the technical look of the film, that they look real and not futuristic. the galaxy that we created in Star Wars and are continuing with Empire is one of real mechanical apparatus that functions and that should appear to work in the context that we know it as an audience.
I think the role of the producer on any film is to gather together all of the elements and provide the director with all the tools he needs on the soundstage and help supervise all the post-production and make sure the film gets properly finished. And also work with the distributor on advertising and publicity and how the film is distributed.
He's what I call a working producer. I mean, he knows what's going on. If there are problems, I can always count on him. It's terrific having someone who knows the business and who cares and who's experienced a great deal. I also have George Lucas. There's George at the end of a telephone. You see, the hotline. George sees all the rushes. It's all sent back. And he sees it, and sometimes he calls me and says, hey, I love that, I love that, I love that, I love that.
Expensive operation. It's a long way from London, and what's more, it requires a lot of logistical coordination to get all the people and the equipment and everything up onto the top of the glacier.
We're going back to us again, Alan. But Alan, how can you do the immediate thing?
Are you busy laying out the cable? Okay. Turn all standing groups on it, just be busy.
Now,
fellas, on Bob, through the loud hailer, bang!
Colin,
will you all scurry for the trenches?
Start charging down.
Yes? From the middle of the track.
Group two now, please. Group two.
Of you, if you stand over that side, because they're shooting in that side.
Okay. Good lad,
you are just preparing for
otherwise it'd be a total joke, but go off to the left.
The war has started now.
Yeah.
The attackers are coming from over there, and you're shooting at them. There's explosions going on all around you. Okay?
Okay down there.
Take your position.
Not far enough, sir.
Any questions? Right, Vader.
Secret now is to ignore him, ignore her, and be looking around. That's it. It's moving around there a little bit there, and you're looking that way. Right. Now it looks like he's looking and he's independent of you. Right. We'll have to have the camera about there. The next moment we cut to your point of view, thing moving, and then we'll move in and get the double. And we'll just smash him and he'll go over. Anytime you got parallels like that, it's phony.
Yeah.
Hey, what do you mean? Those are my two real ones.
It's phony. If it's all pulled to a halt, bang, 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 dismount, run,
no,
you're going to lose it. It's
no,
gotta
that's
be,
right, that's right.
That's why it has to be your shift, because nothing else will hold the pause. That I'm just... Oh, that's fine. Here, put it.
Broken goggles.
All right. Action! Looking back, all the way back. That's right. Back here. Find him. Take the stuff off. You're seeing it. That's it. Out!
That's it.
Well, we've got
cutaways,
Charlie.
Right, exactly. I mean, you're never, ever going to... You're going to make three cameras.
Well,
we've got 1 hour before we get a snowstorm. Let's go,
Bruce. When I start doing that...
Should do.
Science fiction has certain qualities that you have to respect. All kinds of scientific jargon. We've eliminated all scientific jargon. There's almost none. Just a touch, like salt and pepper. It's not a science fiction movie.
Luke, I have no approach vector. I'm not set.
Steady, Dak. Attack pattern Delta. Go now. All right, coming in. Harvey, you still with me?
Do it the other side.
Just the part we are clamoring up.
Starting now. That's it. Okay, set it up right here.
Okay. Face away from here.
All right.
We got off the smoke.
Thank you.
location that looked desolate and icy. The key reason for this one was that its access, because of the railroad, very easily accessible. However, this weather is more fierce than is usually the case here.
They could be cleaning up that area there. Anyone else with some soup?
It's almost unreal. Nothing grows here. The weather's bad, which is what we want. And it looks like another planet. Cold makes problems for everybody.
Snow off the lens is the worst thing. The snow, the wind is so strong it's blowing the snow right into the lens all the time. Then we have to condition the cameras first of all before we come here. We test them in deep freezers, change the oil to a thin oil so they can run more easily. We have to have lots of heaters on all the different parts of the equipment to make sure the film doesn't snap. It has to be heated up as well in the magazines. It's all a question of fighting the cold.
Yes.
Stumble! Keep going. Straight ahead is always towards the branch. Roll down now. Cut!
He's just rolled down.
Yeah, that's the head position.
Where the tackle board is now.
All right.
Okay.
Okay, cover.
Yeah.
All right, roll.
23B, take one guide track.
Tell him when you're in. Talk to him first so he knows what's happening.
The whole film is little pieces, which in which a piece will be done back in the studio to match a piece here, and you have to match weather and the various elements to put them all together. So you're constantly thinking of weather and of where you're shooting it and whether there's too much snow, less snow, how cold it is, and getting a performance at the same time.
Up a little bit. That's it. How's that?
Sport.
Take it, Rachel.
We're tired with
her. Who's Brian Wardrobe?
full of smoke.
How am I going to be attached to that? Just assume the guy's taking him out.
Doing the bumper stuff.
Yes.
Well, Des, it's our big scene together.
Are you dragging me by my arm or my leg?
Leg.
Oh, great.
Be a left leg.
Start to walk.
Which way?
Anyway, just walk forward.
If we could turn around to us slightly.
Very fine, Des. Come on.
Oh, well, them are okay.
It's very, Peter, very important that when Alan starts pulling, he keeps a distance of the arm.
Like when Des goes forward.
That's what we're thinking.
One, two, three.
Five.
They pulled me up.
I don't look good.
Okay.
Okay, Des. Right, lift.
I don't think that's going to work. We'll have to do it by hand.
It's the surface and being not able to see anything when I'm inside the head. Everything is just a complete nothing. Same as before, really. Soft snow, find a little dip, and it's impossible to control exactly how you put your foot down with these boots.
You want to take the weight on my shoulder, Dave? Yeah. Are you coming back?
Well, no. Still, we should overcome.
That's good.
The stuff's still flying in the air. It just disintegrated. Wham!
Yeah.
Up you come, Pete. Just show us your face. Keep coming, keep coming. Hold it there. Don't look at camera, though. Look to the right. I think we're...
You know, we do cut about here, so I don't think you're in any
good.
Okay.
I don't
think that's very good.
Are you good on that? I'm good. Stop
her. In some respects, it's nice that you can hide behind a character. And, just sort of be yourself, and yet the character comes through.
D2, the robot. Nobody knows who it is. They know there's somebody in there. They don't know me personally, but they know that I'm in there. They're not lines, they're just sounds, whistles and bleeps that come across via special effects. So I don't have to really learn any script.
Don't try to bait me. I didn't ask you to turn on the thermal heater. I merely commented that it was freezing in the princess's chamber. But it's supposed to be freezing. Aren't we going to dry out all her clothes? I really don't know. Go switch off.
I think C-3PO is marvellous. I think he's such a nice character. That's the reason I did it, because I happen to like him. 3PO is, I think, very like an English butler. He's that particularly British sort of person. Very archaic and rather... he should really be in a museum. There aren't too many people that can support a character like that. One or two stately homes in England might have somebody like that now. But he's really out of his time. He's being left far behind. And consequently, he finds all the things that happen in Star Wars, you know, the battles, the explosions, all the nasty characters like Darth Vader, he finds that very worrying. He'd much rather be at home serving the drinks to, you know, the family, to Luke and the princess and so on. So he hates all this. You know, he says he hates space travel. He hates a lot of other things too. And it's surprising that he's allowed himself to turn up in this, The Empire Strikes Back.
Excuse me, sir.
Put him back together right now.
Might I have a word with you, please?
What do you want?
Well, it's Princess Leia, sir. She's been trying to get you on the communicator.
I turned it off. I don't want to talk to her.
Oh, well, Princess Leia is wondering about Master Luke. He hasn't come back yet. She doesn't know where he is.
I don't know where he is.
Nobody knows where he is.
What do you mean nobody knows?
Well, you said...
Deck officer! Deck officer!
Excuse me, sir. Mind I...
Yes, sir. You know where Commander Skywalker is?
I haven't seen him. It's possible he came in through the south entrance.
It's possible. Why don't you go find out? It's getting dark out there.
Yes, sir.
Excuse me, sir. Might I inquire what's going on?
Why not?
Impossible, man. Come along, Arthur. Let's find Princess Leia. Between ourselves, I think Master Luke is in considerable danger.
Right. Hold on.
The second time is around the back. Looking.
This one is made in foam rubber, so the mouth and these can move.
Incense burner for the Tauntaun's breath to get him to breathe in and supply the oxygen through the other pipe to push it out. Push it forward.
Move it! Very good. Come on, what's the matter? You saw something? Get it out of here.
Cut it.
Jaws there. That.
You want to
do
the
head.
That.
The eyes.
Maybe you have to move it slightly. Sir. Just give it a kick over.
One foot.
Action! Hold it. No, that's... Hold it. It's too much jittery. It's too jittery.
Yeah, just for a moment.
Go again, right away.
Hey, steady, girl. Come on. Come on, you smell something? There's nothing out here.
We have to shoot 24 frames to equal 1 second. And we have to keep in mind every single tiny movement that we make on this guy. So in like one frame of film, if this guy is running along the ice, he has to be like raised a tiny bit. Okay, and then like his back leg has to be moved a little bit like that. His foreleg has to like come forward. And his head has to go down and maybe up a little bit. All of his bags have to be moved. The rider has to like rock on the saddle in relationship to whether this guy's going up or down. And
So the rider's completely articulate and he's moved. And all the little, you know, pieces of filigree on the saddle are moved too. And then we take one frame of film. This matches into all the cuts with the full-size 8-foot-tall tauntaun that the live-action actors are riding on top of. And we have to be real careful about matching the actions in this animal to the actions in the cuts of the live actors. Say in the scenes where the actors are moving around, the full-size tauntaun moves real radically from left to right. We have to start our cut with the tauntaun moving from left to right in the same speed. We shot 71 frames of film, so for 3 seconds it takes about 5 or 6 hours.
This is the Yoda. First of all, a puppet was made to get some idea what it would look like in three dimensions rather than just a drawing. And this little fella was made purely for that. And as you can see, he's quite an interesting little character. But now he is a puppet, so we now have to make what we hoped to appear to be the real thing rather than just a puppet. So this is made out of foam rubber, and it's going to be full of mechanics to give as many movements as we can possibly achieve. He's only 2 feet high, but he can do pretty nearly everything. He can stand on branches, and he can go underwater. He can do all sorts of funny things. He's going to talk. His mouth, you know, and lips, everything moves. His eyes move in all directions. Eyelids, his ears waggle, and little frowning expressions. We hope to make him smile. And of course all the head movements. He's quite a clever little fellow. He's 400 years old, and of course he has the power of the Force. In fact, I think he is the Force himself.
Teamwork. It's a number of really complex elements which have to be combined, which involves model shops, art department, optical, roto work. There's a whole series of elements that go together. There's 80 people working in very close proximity to each other over a period of about a year. So that involves a lot of emotional problems and everybody fitting in with everybody else. It can be pretty sticky at times, but you know, so far we're doing fine, and it's probably the best crew with this sort of work in mind that I've ever worked with. This contains every single story, every single picture that we have to produce. There's a whole series. There are basically 444, I think. Take this one, for instance. We have a planet in the background, stars behind that. They're shot as separate elements. Then we have X-wings, a rebel transport, and from a pinpoint on the planet's surface, two laser beams come shooting past the X-wings. So we have a number of different elements that have to be combined together, and we have those described down the right-hand side, rebel transport, and all the other things. I think we have one with about 25 or 26 elements. That includes Star Destroyer, TIEs, the Falcon, a number of asteroid passes because they're flying through asteroid belts and stars and lasers and everything else.
This is the joystick that operates the camera and model functions. We've got 12 pots here operating 12 stepping motors, and each channel can be recorded separately and then played back through the memory system, and then we can build upon that to get our final motions. We've got camera track, camera boom, model pitch, model nodal, roll, traverse, and then these are camera motions here, tilt and pan, and camera roll, and then we have two extra channels that we can record either program a focus or record motors on a model or something like that.
Okay, ready and go.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9.
Good. This unit is the memory for the computer control, and it runs the camera. And we program information into it, and it remembers it and runs the camera.
Okay, run that back.
9, 8, 7, 6, 5. 4, 3, 2, 1, 0.
Okay.
Let's see, mercury control frames, brings. I think that position is good on the walker.
Ready, Paul?
Yeah.
Okay.
That's the one that pulls up.
There is no camera available, which is an up-to-date, modern, special effects-oriented reflex camera in our format, which is a large negative format. So I built one which runs at sound speed, which will remember the pans and tilts that you do on location so that you can repeat them exactly with a miniature background. So thereby you can put miniatures into scenes. I have a high-speed camera which runs at 4 times normal speed. A rule of thumb is the faster your camera can run, the smaller the miniature that you can build. So if your camera can run 100 frames a second, you only have to build something where a man is this big in scale, whereas if your camera can only run 24 frames a second, you have to use a real man.
What we have here is a microprocessor developmental system. We use microprocessors throughout the equipment we build, which are microcomputers. And to develop the programs that we use in those microcomputers, we need this equipment. It's a system that specifically allows us to design the control functions that we need. It allows us to, after we build the equipment, to actually test it.
Because of the complexity of all the shots that we do, and because this is, and many times we're compositing as many as 15 to 20, sometimes more, separate pieces of film, or as we call them, elements together to create one final piece, it became necessary for us in the production scheduling of the work that occurs in the facility to try and have a visual overview of where we stood at any given point in time.
great harpoon. Good shot, Jensen.
What I'm doing is I'm removing a black line, which is the rope that this speeder is carrying around to animate around the footsteps of this large walker. And this is done frame by frame. This shot is about 69 frames long, and it's all got to be animated by hand. We'll also give the appearance that there's a shadow moving around the speeder's legs, too, to add slightly more realistic look to the picture.
Few of the map paintings we're using on Empire Strikes Back. This is an example of one that is an interior of Darth Vader's Star Destroyer bridge, where we've added the windows and the ceiling. And this is the interior of the ice cave. And you can see we've added the roof and part of the Falcon in the background. Well, the main thing with the painting is that the painting has to match in color to the color of the set. And, of course, the painting isn't done until after the shot is made, so it's possible then to take the shot and line up the walls or the roof or the buildings or whatever exists exactly to the shot. You do the painting afterwards. However, you then have to take many tests to make sure that the color balances, the lighting balances, and all those things, so that you're not capable of seeing where the painting ends and the live action or the plate, the clear area, begins. This matte painting shows the Millennium Falcon having landed at Cloud City, and you can see Cloud City in the background below the landing platform. In the clear area of glass, Han Solo comes out and meets his hosts at Cloud City.
Hey! Why, you slimy, double-crossing, no-good swindler. You got a lot of guts coming here after what you pulled.
How you doing, you old pirate? So good to see you. I never thought I'd catch you again.
Well, he seems very friendly.
Yes. Very friendly.
What are you doing here?
Repairs. I thought you could help me out. What have you done to my ship?
Your ship?
Hey, remember, you lost her to me fair and square.
And how you doing, Chewbacca? You still hanging around with this loser?
Hello, what have we here?
Welcome, I'm Lando Calrissian. I'm the administrator of this facility. And who might you be?
Leia.
Welcome, Leia.
We built a new optical printer, which is an enormous monster of a machine, which has the finest possible optics that could be developed. We're in the fortunate position of being as close to a NASA-type situation.
What we must do is actually re-photograph the originally filmed images, and that is done by this camera, and the filmed images, previously filmed images, are run through this projector and this projector, and the light comes through this condenser system. There is a filmed image on this plane. It's transmitted through this lens. There is another filmed image on this plane. And that is also transmitted through this lens, and it ends up in the camera on the raw stock.
fantasy film, we have an imaginary world. In a film such as Star Wars and now The Empire Strikes Back, we're dealing with imaginary environments, imaginary vehicles, weapons, strange creatures, all sorts of electronic equipment or some sorts of odd equipment, things we've never have never existed. So there are no real sounds that are recorded while the movie's being filmed. The spaceships don't make any noise. The people are walking around on cardboard sets and plywood, and all of the sounds of simple things such as their footsteps, as well as the sounds of planets exploding or spaceships flying through space, have to be invented and tailored especially for this kind of movie. The way that I go about creating sounds is to first of all gather a lot of raw material. On this particular film, I spent some time at White Sands Missile Range in New Mexico recording missiles and related sounds. We spent a lot of time at Army bases recording weapons and explosions. Some of the crew went on board the USS Ranger, the aircraft carrier, and recorded all sorts of strange elevator motors and airplanes landing and taking off. Most recently, we went to Hoover Dam to record the sounds of the generators and the sounds of the penstocks in the dam being flushed, a giant earthquake type of sound. We had someone make some special arrows for us that make a strange whistling sound as they go through the air. We're going to record that for a particular sound for a weapon in the picture. The second step after we've gathered all this raw material is to bring it in here to this place, which I call the sound laboratory. And here we can, in a sense, perform surgery on the sound. We can take it apart. We can take many sounds and mix them together. The usual things we can do, play them backwards, alter the pitch, cut them into little bits and reassemble them in different ways. There's a lot of editorial work which can be done with this raw material. For instance, we've taken the sound of a cougar roar and the sound of a dragster going by and the sound of a biplane with whistling wires in its wings doing a spin, things that we've recorded, and we take these and mix them together to get the desired effect. So it becomes, each sound effect becomes somewhat of a salad in which we've gathered the various vegetables together and we've sort of stirred them up into a strange mixture.
To set levels for you, I'll just give you bar 13 a few times.
Right. Okay.
13, please, gents, and only 13. Just that measure. 1, 2, 3, 4. Winds alone, please. Let me see what's your problem. It is under a line. Should be. God, you never tongue it. 13. 1, 2, 3. Winds. Good. Tutti, please. 13. 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay for you, good.
All right.
Okay, we take it, please. All right, here it is, Jen.